The new MG5 has arrived.
Welcome to the future, electrified with MG5. We first had the MG5 SW EV, and that gave us a taster of things to come. Now we have the first electric estate car in Europe.
Or SW, which is station wagon. And this offers the highest range of an MG so far. 214 combined, or up to 276 in the city, and these are WLTP figures.
That's incredible, isn't it?
It is. Prices for the range start at £24,495 for the Excite. We have the exclusive, which is £26,995, both after the grant.
Now you have a 52.5 kilowatt per hour battery, and yes, we've had lots of questions. For example, is it water cooled? Does it have a heat pump? Now we've sent off all these questions to MG, and we'll do a Q&A later this week. And no, we're not going to remove this.
And when it comes to charging, you can rapid charge up to 80% in just 50 minutes.
Now the first thing you're probably asking yourself is, why does it not look like the current design language of MG? Well, it's based on the Roe i5, and that's a car that's come out of China. So expect facelifts to look radically different. It's practical, it's roomy, it offers performance of 0 to 60 in around 7.7 seconds. And here's the interesting thing, we took it on one heck of a journey up across the Rhino's Pass and the Hard Knot Pass. So check out here for the road trip.
First things first. This does look a little different to the other cars in the range, but there's a reason for that. This is based on the Roe i5, and that's been in production since 2018. So it's been brought into the MG fold, and it's now the 5 in Europe. So you can rest assured that with facelift models, it's going to be far more MG. And to be honest, it's not a bad looking car. Yes, the grille is different, but you still have a prominent MG badge, and you have the charging port behind it that you've come to expect from the ZS EV. The grille is draped in chrome and gloss back plastic. It does look like some German brand, and some people have said it's a bit Astra K-y. What are your thoughts? It does make sense considering that SAIC make lots of parts for lots of manufacturers. Now, safety and tech are a little bit limited on this vehicle, as it doesn't have the full suite of safety that you've come to expect with an MG. No cross-traffic alert, no blind spot detection. Other things as well that Ben will cover when we look at the interior. It comes with automatic halogen projection headlamps with LED daytime running lights and rain sensing wipers. Rest assured though, it does have AEB. Optional metallic paint will cost you £495, and the tri-coat paint will cost you £695. Both the Excite and the Exclusive come with 16-inch meter alloy wheels. Expect different sizes and different designs in future models. We have electrically operated, power folding, heated door mirrors. There is no blind spot detection on either trim in the 5 range at the moment. The styling on the side is simple, there's no black cladding, there's no sportiness, but it doesn't need it. You do have chrome handles, which we've seen previously on the ZS, and the chrome envelops the entire windows, giving it a nice executive feel. And these silver roof rails do accentuate the length. One thing I would like to see is a panoramic sunroof in this car, hoping that's going to be seen in future models. One thing to note, SAIC don't fit privacy glass in their cars. It is available aftermarket, especially if you're looking for UV protection, it can easily be done. And they've got all-round disc brakes which are vented at the front. Yes, the design language at the back is going to look different because it's based on the Roe i5, and I'm sure you've got your own ideas on which models it's reminiscent of. Ben and I certainly do. However, we do love this rear end. Rear end. And the sculpting on these rear lenses is very stylish. The chrome continues, it's even around here. It does have a high-level brake light embedded in the deep sporty spoiler, but there's no aerial. One thing to note, the MG badge is not the boot popper. Ideally, you'll see that on future models, but don't quote me on that. And you've got parking sensors and a camera. And don't forget that 7-year warranty. One really cool nifty feature, that if you press and hold the unlock button on the key fob, it does this. Which means when you're locking up, if anyone, like say your children, have left one of the windows open, if you press and hold it to lock it, as you walk away, puts all the windows up. Now it's time to charge. For demonstration purposes, we've got a home charger and a Type 2. MG furnished them in these snazzy bags. Obviously, when it comes to rapid charge, those cables are connected to the unit, so you won't have one with you in the car. We use that map app to tell us where those points are, and you'll generally need an account or a debit card to make sure you can pay quickly and easily. I'm going to use the home charger to demonstrate how easy it is to charge the 5. Get your 3-pin plug. And for charging, make sure you have the key with you because it does have locking functions. Unlock the car. That unlocks the port. I'm charging at home, so I'm only going to use the top one. There's my port. I'm going to plug it in. Just a note on this first model, there are no lights in this area to tell you it's charging, so let's go and look at the dash. It would be nice to see the pulsing MG badge at the front as it charges on future models. There you go, it gives you the time, it gives you the percentage of the charge, and how many miles of range you have. It would have been nice to see an estimated time of full charge. Now, charging at home, it's going to take you around 18 hours to get to 100%. If you use a Type 2 at 7 kilowatts, it's going to take about 8.5. Rapid charge options, around 50 kilowatts is going to give you an 80% charge in 50 minutes. Around 100 kilowatts will get you to the 80% in 40 minutes. A full charge will give you a 214-mile range, and that's WLTP. When you're ready to leave, you unlock the car using the key fob. This releases the charging port. Pull that out. Pop the cover on. And replace your bungs. Shut the port and you're good to go. Don't forget to store your cable safely.
The new MG5, let's see how easy it is to get into. We've got a decent ride height, so that should aid us. Add keyless entry, perfect. As long as you've got the key on your person, you just press this button. The doors open nice and wide. And it's a decent opening too. One thing to note, there is no grab handle. It's not too far to reach either. As soon as you step into the MG5, there's a feeling of familiarity. The rotary dial that we saw in the ZS EV, nice and simple to use, and good build quality as well. I love this centre console. You've got an integrated infotainment screen there, sporty steering wheel, some nice materials dotted about, and some comfortable buckety seats. Yes, there are hard plastics, but this is an electric estate car for under £25,000 if you go for the Excite. That's remarkable. You've got all-round electric windows, and interestingly, on the right-hand side here, you've got a start-stop button. You can also adjust your headlamp height here, and you've got your power-folding electric door mirror operations here as well. Steering wheel-wise, it's well-trimmed. On the left-hand side, telephony controls and media. On the right-hand side, that's where you operate the computer, in between the two analog clocks. You've got a speedo on the left and an efficiency gauge on the right. It's got some symbols I'm not even familiar with. Scrolling through there, I can see things like the tire pressure monitoring system, gives you electrical information. At the bottom, shows you what driving mode you're in, and to the right, you can see what level curves you're in. That's the thing about this being based on the Roe. It's not quite as refined as the MG. Moving to the centre, integrated infotainment screen and the familiar system that you've seen in other MGs. It's not the biggest, but it doesn't need to be. You've got DAB, you've got Apple CarPlay, you've got Android Auto. You can also set some of the car's settings. And yes, that is navigation. Now, where this vehicle lacks is safety. NCAP is yet to be determined, but it's not going to be as high as the ZS EV because it hasn't got things like lane keep assist, lane departure warning, pedestrian and bicycle detection, any of the MG Pilot suite. So just bear that in mind. You've got some shortcut buttons here, a nice rotary dial for the volume, heated seats, and below that, a 12 volt socket, two USBs, and your aircon. Rotary dial on the left to turn it on, and fan speed on the right. Some shortcut buttons with rear demister and things like that. You've got your driving modes, eco, normal, and sport. Also displays that on the cluster. And KERS, or for lack of a better word, regenerative braking. 1, 2, and 3. On 3, your brake lights come on. And a battery mode. And yes, a very nice rotary selector. Reverse, neutral drive, and park if you press it down. Electronic handbrake with hill hold assist and auto hold. You also have an auto dimming mirror. It's a nice comfortable driving position. As you can see, I've got ample headroom and I'm 6'3". Got decent legroom as well. It's a two-pedal system because it's an electric car, a bit like the automatic. On the left-hand side, I've got a footrest. I have an electric seat, but the passenger's is manual. It's very comfortable, it's well finished, and it's quite buckety as well. The driving position is good too. Leather armrest in the center and a padded area for your arm on the right. The steering wheel also has reach and rake. You've got a decent-sized door bin, two cup holders in the centre, storage point here, And under the armrest, it's not the biggest area, but you quite easily get a drink in there or some snacks. And finishing with the glove box, that's of a decent size. And your bonnet release is here. Let's see how easy it is to get into the rear of the MG5. Its decent ride height should make it simplicity. The doors open nice and wide, and it's a decent opening. One thing I have noticed is the seat's quite high, so I may have to duck down. Let's find out. Yes, so if you're taller like me, just take care when climbing in. You do have a grab handle, and it's nice and easy to grab this. It's an interesting seating position once you step into the back. This seat is higher, as I mentioned, when getting in, which means I've got a higher view out of the windscreen. But because I'm 6'3", if it was any taller, I wouldn't actually be able to see out the window. So that's something to note. Headroom, as you can see, at 6'3", I've just enough. So any taller, and you would have to scooch really low in the seat. It's nice and light and airy in here, even without a sunroof, but you've got a nice light headliner. You also have this pull-down armrest with two cup holders. It's very comfortable. I also like the angle of the rear seat. It's not too upright. Perfect for a long journey for two people. Three people on shorter journeys and three children, no problem. Now, one thing I've noticed is I can't get my feet under the front seats, but I do have a decent sized footwell. Now, you've got airbags up here, but it doesn't appear there's any airbags back here, but there are ISOFIX points on the seat. There's also a grab handle above each door except the driver's. We've got mat pockets on the back of the seats, and the door card is nicely finished, hard plastic at the top, but you've got some nice inlays and a nice padded area for your hand as well. Electric window and decent sized door pocket. You've also got two USBs here and some fins at the bottom. The boot's nice and easy to open with keyless entry. As long as you've got the key on you, you're sorted. If you prefer, you can pop the boot using the button on the fob. The release is just under here, as Annabelle mentioned. Now, being 6'3" may be beneficial in some ways, but in other ways it is a bit of a challenge, and I've got to be careful I don't bop my head, so bear that in mind. This reveals a 464-litre load space. Now, that's under the cover. You can increase that to 578 if you stack to the roof. Yes, you do have quite a boot lid. Now, you could put a false floor in, but that would eat up literally 30% of your boot space, so this format makes sense. It would be nice to see on future models this a little lower, but then you've got the problem of bending down, so somewhere in between would be perfect. You have the snazzy load cover that just pulls out, and we've got some charging cables as well. Storage points on the right. Realistically, this could be used as a storage point as well. Under the carpet, an inflation kit. It's a decent square space, and you can easily get some luggage in there. And if you drop the seats, that will increase to 1456. They're split folding 60-40, and very easy to drop. You just literally push this forward. And that releases the seat. Now, because there is no false floor, you do have a lip between the seat and the boot floor. There are no tethering points, and you don't have any shopping bag hooks either. And it doesn't look as a 12-volt socket either, but there is space for one. There's also a warning triangle down here. Load-wise, I mentioned you can get a lot of luggage in the boot, but if you drop the seats, you'll also get two mountain bikes in here easily, and I think this is the perfect car to go mountain biking. It's nice and quiet, and it won't annoy any squirrels, badgers, or anything like that. Fabulous MG5. You have a 115 kilowatt electric motor, 52.5 kilowatt per hour electric battery, which generates 260 newton meters of torque. It gives you a range of around 214 miles. Let's try sport mode out of a junction. So, light acceleration to start with. We're now at boost, which is 100, and we're up to the limit.
Whoa.
Okay, one thing to note, if you're pulling out of a junction, may wheel spin, but when you put your foot down, it grips well. Nice comfortable soft suspension as well. It feels a nice comfortable ride. It's very quiet like this, even with the window down. Corners well, feels well planted, sure footed, but it's got a lot of weight with the batteries in it, so they do. This will feel very familiar to anybody who's driven the MG ZS EV. It is a one-speed drive as well. And you've got your driving modes, KERS, and battery as well. Motorway speeds, it just feels
steady, great. Well-planted, comfortable.
Yeah, exactly. You can change lanes quite easily. It's just not a problem. I mean, you can literally weave along in this. As soon as I put my foot down, you can quite easily exceed motorway limits.
Well, it's not going to zip through your range too much, is it?
No, it's not.
It's not going to suck too much off it.
You've got a ride height that allows you to be a little adventurous. It's not like it restricts it. It will be quicker in sport, though. Nice responsive steering. It's nice and direct. And you can whip it around as well. Feels good. Weightens up nicely as well. Feel that? You just put your power down. It's just not fazed by the steepness, is it?
No. This is a very interesting road trip for an EV.
Look at this.
Wow.
The regen is holding the car back. So I'm not actually braking at all at the moment. I'm starting to speed up a bit now. But it will hold you a fair level. There's nothing holding you back, is there? It's just instant.
Very much so.
Got discs all around with the front being vented, and you have an electronic handbrake as well. It operates very well.
Both trims in the range of the 5EV have the same safety features, which include EBA, ABS and EBD.
You also get cruise control, don't you?
You do. Airbags, tyre pressure monitors, hill launch assist.
Electronic brake distribution.
And ABS.
NCAP to be determined. You can feel confident in your MG5 when you're doing adventures such as the Rhino's Pass and the Hard Knot Pass. But that means you can do a lot further than you realise, especially if you're economical with your battery. So you recoup, regen when you can, and don't floor it everywhere. With the ZS, because it's got a shorter range, you're a lot more frugal. Whereas with this, I don't need to be as frugal, which is nice. You still get to experience the car in an engaging way without it depleting too much battery.
You could really take this on family adventures, couldn't you?
Oh, it's perfect. Most of the time we're hovering between 0 and 20, though, on the efficiency meter on the right.
And for driving efficiency, the WLTP combined is 3.6 miles per kilowatt hour.
You can be yourself more in this car, can't you?
You can indeed.
You're not range watching. I expected it to deplete the range far more from going up steep hills, going on the motorway at higher speeds, and it just doesn't.
We ended up with 52 miles of range left after travelling just over 115 miles. So we started with 185 miles and ended up with 52. Overall, 1.155 miles of range per 1 mile travelled, which is impressive over such a challenging route. It's versatile, it's practical and good value, with plenty of room and comfort for adventuring. It's nippy, fun to drive, and it'll get you further than you think.